Hey, Aaron Dablo here. I've got a new video for you. It's called the MaxScript Rule of Three. And in my workflow, the first time I do something, I feel like I'm an explorer. I'm figuring out a new way of doing something. I'm coming up with a new technique or method. The second time I do something, I feel like I'm an engineer. I'm crafting the best way and finding out if there's anything that I could do better in it. The third time I do something, I feel like a robot. I try and avoid doing things three times. And that's what I'm going to cover in this video. I'm going to show ways to expose MaxScript controls on any object that you have in your scene and how to quickly edit them and manipulate them across your entire scene, making your workflow a lot more automated. I do have another MaxScript video that goes more into depth in tool creation and how to make more user interface related things, but it's going to cover a few of the same issues. If you are not familiar with MaxScript at all, it might be better to watch that one first, because this one's a little bit quick. First off, I'm going to show you how to change a bunch of common attributes shared between objects. How many times have you imported something and it looks like this? You have a bunch of point helpers, they're all really large, and you can't select or do anything with them. Let's say it's from a 3D track, you can't go about scaling everything, that's going to throw stuff off. Unfortunately, going through each of these one by one isn't a lot of fun. If we open the listener window by hitting F11, you'll see we have two fields. This top one is the listener. By clicking on Macro Recorder and Enable, any action you make in Max will be recorded. As you can see, the size is changing. This lower portion is a script editor that you can type commands into. Let's go ahead and grab this, paste it down in here, and let's say we want to change the size of our object to 5. Let's select one object, click back in here, and press Enter. You'll see it has changed the size of the point. If we select all of our objects, do the same thing, it'll have changed the size for all of them. Let's see what other attributes we can edit on a point helper. If you go and select a point, and toggle on and off the options, you will see that the listener reports what you're doing. If you look at this line, it is reported that we've turned the box on. If we put this down below, select all of our objects, and execute, it has applied that to all of our objects. Already, we're doing things a lot faster. But let's say you want to introduce some variety into the size of your points. This would be the same as making any small tweak to all of your objects to make them look unique. If we go up to MaxScript, New Script, we can copy this and place right in our script. Because our boxes are already on, we don't need this. So if I type random and then give it a range, MaxScript will randomly choose an integer in between these two numbers and apply it to the size. To execute, let's hit Control E. Now what has happened here is all of our objects have received the same random size. It's picking a new random size each time and applying it to all of the objects. If we want to change size on each of them individually, we'll need to introduce a for loop. So let's add for I, which is the iteration through the loop of objects in 1, we'll do 1 by 1, 2, selection, that's our objects we have selected, dot count, that's the number of them, do. We'll put this inside of some brackets that'll execute in, and then because our selection right here, that was previously all of our objects, we need to change this to the iteration that we're on, its object. So selection, brackets, I. When we execute this by hitting Control E, you'll see it has applied a new random size to each of our objects. We can execute this many times and get a different result. It's a quick and easy way to get a bunch of variety in your scene. So finding out the properties that you can edit on an object oftentimes can be a little bit challenging. You can access the help file, look for your object that you're trying to edit, and scroll through and see that you have size, center marker, cross, box, all of these things. It's not listed out in a very accessible manner. What you can do is in the listener, first clear these out by hitting Control D, select one object, and use the function Show Properties. If we show the properties of what we have selected, it'll show all the editable attributes of this object. Show Properties works on things other than objects that you have selected. If we check out our renderers, which is a system global, it'll print out some information for us. Off of our renderers, let's get our current one, and you can see that that's our default scanline renderer. If we do Show Properties, it'll print off all the properties of our scanline renderer. If we open the render setup and pop over to our renderer tab, you can see that anti-aliasing is off. You can see here, anti-aliasing is listed, and what value it accepts is printed over here. Booleans are true-false, floats are any number with a decimal point, and integers are whole numbers. So what we can do is go ahead and copy this anti-aliasing, tag it right on the end here. Let's get rid of everything else, get rid of this show properties, and if we hit this, you'll see that it's set to false. We can easily change this to its other Boolean value, and if you look, there it goes. It's changed in here. All right, let's clear out all this stuff and make a plane. That's pretty good. And let's start off by adding a displace modifier.
So let's get the attributes of this displace modifier off of this object. The method to get the modifiers of an object are a little bit different than they are to get the properties of something. If I write selection.modifiers, you'll see that it returns a list of my modifiers. Let's put an edit poly, and if we do this again, you'll see that it lists the edit poly and then the displace. Get rid of that. So let's copy this displace and say selectedObject.displace. If we do a show properties and hit enter, you'll see that it returns all of the values of our displace modifier. So here you can see our main value that we want to work with, look through it, and see, strength. This is the intensity of the displace modifier. Let me copy this, put it right here, and let's start our script. We can set this to 10, control E to execute, and you can see it has edited the displacement value of our modifier. But this only does us good if we already have a modifier on there. If we want to construct a new modifier, let's start with new displace. This is a variable that will temporarily hold the settings for the displacement modifier before we add it to the object. Equals displace, that's the constructor. It tells Max that what we have here is a displacement modifier. And let's set our strength. Now this is a little bit new syntax. It's not equaling, it's setting the value in a different way. This is because we're not editing something that already exists, we're constructing it this way. To add this to our current selected object, we use add modifier. Let's get our selection, and then new displace. We'll add the modifier to selection that is this, which is our variable, which has stored this information. If we go ahead and delete this, and execute it, you'll see that we've created a new displace modifier with this value. But what good is a displace modifier without a map in it? First, let's see where that map should go. If we do selection.displace and do show properties to that, you'll see that we have map. This corresponds with this slot right here for us to put a map into. So going back to our script, if we say to our new displace, dot map equals, we need to have a map. So let's go and construct one first. Let's use a cellular map. So new cellular equals cellular. As you can see, it's green, so it's a constructor. And in the cellular map, you just go here, hit F1, it'll pull up our help, and we can see all of our things we would like to do to it. So let's go ahead and set its size. And like we were doing earlier, we can set that to a random value. And then with this new cellular map is what we will put into the displacement map. I'll go ahead and delete this, and let's execute the script. Great, if we move over here, you can see that we've added our cellular map into here, and our strength has been set to 10. Now let's set this on a bunch of objects. First, let's delete this, and I'll make a bunch of objects, and we'll do our for loop that we learned earlier. For iteration in 1x1 to the number of objects that we have, new, our script. And now, again, because we're using a for loop, we need to change our selection to the iteration number that we're in. And while we're at it, let's add a turbo smooth before the displacement modifier so we have more detail. So let's add modifier to our object and turbo smooth, and let's give it 4 iterations. If I select all of these objects and execute our script, you can see that we have 4 different versions of a cellular map applied to our objects. That little method right there is pretty much the only thing used in making all of the objects in the debris maker script. So here are some objects that were created completely using that method that I was showing you earlier. And if I select one, you can just see that it has more objects on it. But these are all just started out as boxes.
All right, that's it for this one. Let me know what you think. Leave some feedback, and there'll be plenty more of these coming, so feel free to stay tuned for more. Thanks for watching.